Recorded Books and RB Digital present John Bellairs' Louis Barnevelt in The Tower at the End of the World by Brad Strickland, narrated by George Guidall. Chapter 1. Louis Barnevelt closed his book with a snap. He popped the last of his chocolate-covered peppermints into his mouth. He didn't chew it, but let the sweet chocolate melt on his tongue, releasing the cool mint taste. Then he sat in the lawn chair under the old chestnut tree in front of 100 High Street with his chin in his hand. He wasn't smiling. In fact, he looked decidedly gloomy. There was no obvious reason. It was a warm, breezy June day in the 1950s. School had recently ended, and Louis had a whole summer of freedom ahead, days when he could do just about anything you could do in the town of New Zebedee, Michigan. And he looked forward to nights when he and his uncle Jonathan Barnevelt could haul out their telescope and stargaze in the backyard. But none of that helped much at the moment. All Louis could feel then was grumpy, grouchy, and irritable. It didn't even help when he heard his friend Rose Rita Pottinger call out to him from the street, "Hi, Louis. What have you got on? You mind?" Louis made a face. He got enough ridicule at school, he thought, and he didn't need Rose Rita's ribbing, even if it was good-humored. Louis was a heavy-set boy of about 13, with a round moon face and hair that he slicked back with oil and parted in the center. He was anything but athletic. When the kids played baseball or softball, Louis was always the last one chosen, if he was chosen at all. He had always been timid about getting hurt, and he didn't dare try to join in the rough-and-tumble football games the other kids played in the fall. And though he could usually take gentle teasing from Rose Rita, or from his uncle or Mrs. Zimmermann, their next-door neighbor, today his mood was just too dismal. So he stood up with a dramatic sigh and said, "I was about to go take a nap." Rose Rita pushed open the wrought-iron gate in front of Louis's house, which was a three-story stone mansion. She grinned and said, "Well, I think you'll change your tune when you hear my news." "I doubt it," said Louis. Rose Rita tilted her head to one side. She was somewhat taller than Louis, and she was skinny, with long, straight, dark hair. She wore big round glasses and looked sort of gawky and clumsy, though she could run like the wind and could outpitch almost any boy in a game of baseball.
"Come on, don't be a gloomy Gus. What's the matter with you?"
Louis sniffed.
"Nothing," he shrugged. "Just bored, I guess."
That wasn't the whole truth. In fact, Louis, who loved to read, had just finished the very last novel about Dr. Fu Manchu. He was a Chinese master criminal, whom the author, Sax Rohmer, described as having a forehead like Shakespeare's and a face like Satan's. In every book, the evil Fu Manchu's plots failed at the last minute because the criminal was beaten by his nemesis, a stalwart British detective named Nayland Smith. Now that Louis had finished reading The Shadow of Fu Manchu, he realized he had no more of the adventures to discover, and that made him feel cranky. Rose Rita stared at him for a minute. Everything was silent except for the rustling of the chestnut leaves in the breeze. Then she asked, "Where's your uncle?"
"Out back," said Louis. "He decided to do some flower gardening."
Rose Rita's eyebrows shot up. Jonathan Barnevelt had attended an agricultural college when he was young. But then he'd inherited a pot of money from his grandfather. Every year he planted a vegetable patch in the rear of the backyard, but usually he was too lazy to plant any flowers.
"Let's go see him," said Rose Rita. "This involves him too."
Louis was interested despite himself. In a way, he still wanted to brood about not having any more Sax Rohmer books to read. But something about Rose Rita's manner made him curious. He dropped his book on the lawn chair, but he kept his tone gruff.
"Okay, I'll go with you."
They walked around back. Jonathan Barnevelt knelt beside a flower bed. He was wearing tan wash pants, a blue work shirt, and his red vest. He also wore brown cotton work gloves, and he was wielding a rusty trowel as he set out the last of some colorful petunias.
"Hello, you two,"
he boomed with a big smile as Rose Rita and Louis came around the corner of the house. He got to his feet, dusted off the knees of his trousers, and peeled off the gloves. Then he stood with his hands on his hips, admiring his handiwork.
"There. Every year Florence kids me about not growing anything but sweet corn and tomatoes in my yard. I guess this will show her. I mean to have some prize petunias this year." He wiped sweat from his forehead with a big red bandana, leaving a brownish smudge of soil.
That's hard work. I'm thirsty for some nice cold lemonade. Care to join me?
Lewis had to fight hard to hold on to his grumpy mood. Ever since his parents had died in a tragic auto accident, Lewis had lived with his uncle in the big house on High Street. Though there were still times when he felt lonesome for his mom and dad, he liked the arrangement a great deal. Jonathan Barneveld was a big man with a pot belly and a bushy red beard. He loved to laugh, he loved to eat, and best of all, he loved magic. He was a sorcerer who could create marvelous magical illusions out of thin air. Because of that and his great sense of humor, living with him was never dull. However, Lewis was determined not to be jollied along, and so he just grunted and shrugged. Jonathan didn't seem to notice. He led the way back to the house and into the kitchen, where he opened the refrigerator and took out a frosty pitcher of lemonade. He poured 3 tall glasses and handed them around.
"A toast," he said, "to warm weather, plenty of rain, and a good growing season."
He clinked glasses with Rosita, but Lewis didn't join in. After a long sip of lemonade, Jonathan said,
"I guess Lewis is in a sour mood today, so this drink should just about suit him."
Lewis frowned.
"I just don't feel much like talking. I don't know why everybody's picking on me today."
"Nobody's picking on you," replied Rosita. "In fact, I came over with a terrific invitation for you. And for your uncle and Mrs. Zimmermann, too. Could we call her over?"
Jonathan shook his head.
"We could if she were home, but Florence is out of town until this afternoon. She had some legal business to settle over in Homer."
Lewis felt a twinge of concern. Their neighbor, Mrs. Florence Zimmermann, was a fabulous cook, a sympathetic and helpful friend, and a witch. Not an evil witch, but a friendly, cheerful, wrinkly-faced good witch whose magic, as Uncle Jonathan always admitted, was much stronger than his own.
"What's wrong, Uncle Jonathan?" asked Lewis. "Did somebody suing Mrs. Zimmermann?"
Looking astonished at the very idea, Jonathan said,
"Suing Haggy Face? Of course not. You know how she's always crabbed about the old fishing dock next to her property on Lion Lake, the one that she says is a public menace because the owner never repairs it? Well, she said for years that she was going to buy the ramshackle old thing from the owner and have it torn down, and now she's finally done it. She's signing the deed today, that's all. So, Rosita, if you want us all together for your invitation, you'll just have to wait."
Rosita was almost bouncing in her chair.
"But I can't wait. It's too exciting. I'll tell you and Lewis, but you'll have to promise not to talk to Mrs. Zimmermann before I get a chance."
Now, Lewis was certainly intrigued. He knew all about the close friendship between Rosita and Mrs. Zimmermann. It was almost as if they were sisters, if one sister could be in her teens and the other about 70.
"Okay, I promise," said Lewis,
and Jonathan added his promise as well. Behind the lenses of her spectacles, Rosita's eyes were dancing.
"You know my grandpa Galway?"
Jonathan Barnabout looked perplexed.
"Of course I know, Albert. What about him?"
Albert Galway, Rosita's grandfather, was a tall, bald old man who was something of a character in Yosemite. Though Mr. Galway always told people he was almost 90, Lewis had recently learned from Rosita that he really was only 81. Still, that was a long life, and in that long life, Mr. Galway had done lots of things. He had run away from home at the age of 16 and had joined the Navy for 4 years. Then he had returned to New Zebedee, finished his schooling, and had become a construction worker, a pretty good photographer and artist, and then an architect. He had rejoined the Navy twice, once for 2 years during World War I, and then another 4-year hitch in the Depression, and had traveled all over the world. He still loved to roam around, and he had a passionate interest in gadgets and gizmos.
"What about your grandpa?" repeated Lewis. "He's going to be up at a place near Porcupine Bay all summer," Rosita told him. "An old Navy buddy of his is off in Australia racing a yacht, and he's asked my grandpa to house it at his mansion. It's on an island in Lake Superior with a sailboat, and Grandpa Galway says we can all come up and visit him."
Lewis's heart thumped. A sailboat? Now, that was interesting. But then he gulped. Lewis was a real worrywart, always imagining the worst, and he thought about all the possible dangers. Porcupine Bay was on the wild upper peninsula of Michigan, a curving finger of land that bent out to the east between Lake Superior to the north and Lake Michigan to the south. Lewis had been there once or twice, and sometimes
He read stories in the newspapers about marauding bears, dangerous lightning storms, and forest fires in the wilderness. What would happen if they were all out on a sailboat and a bad storm blew up? He could picture them falling into the cold waters, floundering and splashing, screaming for help as one by one they drowned. But Jonathan Barnabout looked delighted.
That sounds great. I know Albert's had lots of experience at the helm of a sailing boat, and he's always entertaining to talk to. I'm ready to go right now. How about you, Lewis?
His uncle's enthusiasm forced a smile onto Lewis's face. He swallowed the cold, sour lump of fear that had risen in his throat.
It sounds pretty good, he admitted. I guess it would be fun.
Rosarita gave him an exasperated glance.
Of course it'll be fun. We'll get to explore, and we can pretend that we're the crew of Sir Francis Drake's Golden Hind, bound on a voyage around the world. We can have picnics and go swimming and fishing. Maybe we can even camp out overnight on one of the islands up there. That'll be better than sitting around with our noses stuck in books all summer.
Hey, objected Lewis. Jonathan patted Lewis on the shoulder.
There's nothing wrong with loving to read. Lewis, I've got a suggestion. We'll swing by my favorite used bookstore over in Ann Arbor before we go, and you can stock up on adventure stories. And I'll even spring for a whole case of peppermint patties.
Lewis nodded, and the smile that he had been fighting off curved itself across his face.
That sounds great.
He loved to eat candy while he read, and most of his books had chocolate-colored fingerprints on the corners of the pages.
Okay, I'm in. When do we tell Mrs. Zimmermann?
We don't, Rosita shot back. I do that all by myself. I want it to be my surprise. Rosita stayed for lunch, and after a round of hot roast beef sandwiches and some potato salad, she helped Lewis clean up. Not long after that, Mrs. Zimmermann came rattling along High Street in Bessie, her purple Plymouth, and Rosita and Lewis ran over to her house to give her the news. She laughed at Rosita's excitement as they sat on the purple sofa in her living room, under the oil painting of a purple dragon done for Mrs. Zimmermann years and years earlier by the great French painter Odilon Redon. Mrs. Zimmermann's favorite color was purple, and she made no bones about surrounding herself with it. She wore baggy purple dresses, and even the toilet paper in her bathroom was purple.
My heavens,
she exclaimed when Rosarita had finished. She adjusted her gold-rimmed spectacles on her nose, her eyes gleaming with good humor.
Here I was thinking this was going to be a quiet stay-at-home kind of summer, and now this.
Rosarita, I would be delighted to accept your invitation. Thank Albert for me, and let me know when we're going. Now, who's for some chocolate chip cookies? Lewis licked his lips. His uncle was a rotten cook who could just about manage to turn out an edible sandwich or a hamburger, but Mrs. Zimmermann could dish up delicious meals and scrumptious treats. For half an hour they sat at her kitchen table, gobbling fresh, crunchy cookies and slurping tall glasses of milk. When they had finished, Mrs. Zimmermann said, "Why not take Weirdbeard a dozen cookies? If he's going to be sailing and fishing and hiking, he'll need to keep his strength up." She packed the cookies in a paper lunch bag, and Lewis and Rosarita headed over to Lewis's house. They barged into the living room. The TV set, a Zenith Stratocaster with a perfectly round screen like a porthole, was on. Lewis recognized House Party, an afternoon show that his uncle sometimes watched, but no one was in the living room.
"Uncle Jonathan," called Lewis.
When no answer came, he gave Rosarita an uneasy glance. "I wonder where he is." Rosarita knew how Lewis could work himself up over nothing.
"Probably he's gone upstairs," she suggested, in a reasonable tone. "Maybe he needed a shower after all his work on the flower beds."
But Jonathan wasn't on the second floor, or even on the unused third floor of the house. The two friends came back downstairs, with Lewis feeling more and more tense. It wasn't like his uncle to walk out of a room and leave the TV set or the radio playing. They went toward the kitchen, and Lewis noticed that the door to the cellar was ajar. Then he remembered that Uncle Jonathan stored his fishing tackle down there in a kind of cupboard built into the wall near the furnace.
"I'll bet he's getting out his rods and reels," he said, with relief in his voice. "Come on."
Lewis stepped onto the cellar stairs and looked down into darkness. Surely his uncle would have turned on the light. He fumbled for the switch and clicked it. Nothing happened.
"Uncle Jonathan?"
Lewis called down into the darkness.
"Are you there?"
"I don't like this," mumbled Rosarita. It isn't like him to disappear with no warning.
Get the flashlight from the junk drawer in the kitchen, Lewis told her. She hurried away. Lewis stood on the top step, his heart hammering. Had the light bulb burned out? Had Jonathan started down to change it and tripped in the dark? Was he hurt?
Soon Rosarita was back with the flashlight. Lewis switched it on and sent its bright beam downward. The big yellow oval of light traced the steps, then moved slowly over the concrete basement floor. It came to rest on something long and tan. His uncle's leg.
Lewis hurried downstairs. Jonathan Barnevelt lay motionless on his stomach. His hands flung out, his face was turned away from Lewis, and for a terrible wrenching moment Lewis thought he might be dead. Then the fallen figure stirred and groaned.
Lewis shined the flashlight on Rosarita, who was standing halfway down the steps.
"He's knocked out," he yelled. "Go get Mrs. Zimmermann, quick."
Rosarita flew back upstairs. Lewis knelt beside his unconscious uncle, with only the flashlight to chase away the gloom and darkness of the cellar. He was so worried about Uncle Jonathan that he even forgot to feel afraid of what might be lurking in the dark.
Chapter 2
"Okay,"
rumbled Dr. Humphreys in a deep voice like a bass viol. "How many fingers am I holding up?"
11,
growled Jonathan Barnevelt, sitting propped on a big pile of pillows in his own bed. Lewis, standing at the foot of the bed, gulped hard. Had his uncle's accident made him lose his mind? But then he relaxed as Jonathan continued.
"Of course that's in binomial notation. In decimal terms, it's 3. Does that satisfy you, you pill-pusher?"
Dr. Humphreys laughed.
"Well, your fall down the stairs didn't knock the orneriness out of you, anyhow. You take it easy for a couple of days, Jonathan, and call me if you have any unusual symptoms, like a bad headache, double vision, or tomato vines growing out of your ears."
He turned to Lewis, Rosarita, and Mrs. Zimmermann.
"Nothing too much wrong with bickering Barneveld here. The scientific name of his ailment is bumpus nogginus, otherwise known as a crack on the head. He'll be fine."
"Thank you, doctor," said Mrs. Zimmermann. "It was kind of you to come out so quickly."
The physician winked at her.
"I charge more for a house call,"
he said cheerfully.
"And besides, I love to drive fast. The cops don't dare stop me when I'm on an emergency call."
He picked up his leather case full of rattling square pill bottles and wished them all a good afternoon. As soon as the doctor was out of the door, Jonathan Barnevelt threw off the quilt that had covered him. He had come to in the cellar just as Mrs. Zimmermann and Rosarita came running over, and he had made the climb to his bedroom under his own power. He hadn't undressed, and now he jammed his shoes onto his stockinged feet.
"I feel like a prize nincompoop," he complained.
"What happened, Jonathan?" asked Mrs. Zimmermann.
Jonathan rubbed the top of his head gingerly.
"Darn if I know. I heard someone on the cellar steps, or thought I did. So I opened the door and tried to turn on the light, but the bulb was on the fritz. Then I thought I heard Lewis call me, so I started down the stairs, and the next thing I remember is an almighty thump on the head and lots of pretty spinning colored stars. I guess I must have tripped in the dark."
He tugged at his red beard.
"Lewis, I suppose it wasn't you in the cellar after all."
Lewis shook his head.
"We were next door," he said.
He explained how he and Rosarita had hunted for Jonathan for several minutes before they found him.
"Odd," commented Jonathan. "I could have sworn I heard someone down there. Maybe we'd better check."
"Do you feel up to it?" asked Mrs. Zimmermann.
"I'm not a baby, Florence," replied Jonathan with a touch of exasperation. "I've had lots of bumps and thumps in my time, and none of them has killed me yet."
Lewis's heart pounded. He hated to hear his uncle mention death. Ever since his own parents had died, Lewis had lived with a fear of being left alone in the world. He bit his lip, but didn't say anything. Jonathan dug out a big flashlight, not the small one that was kept in the kitchen drawer, and they all trooped into the cellar. Jonathan fumbled on his shelf for a 100-watt bulb.
"Let me get this in, and we'll see if there's any sign of an intruder."
"Let Lewis do it," suggested Mrs. Zimmermann. "You have no business standing on a ladder after a head injury."
"Yes, Your Majesty," responded Jonathan. "Anything you wish. Lewis, drag out the stepladder."
Lewis climbed up on the ladder. The only light in the cellar hung from the ceiling, in a conical green and white metal shade. He reached up to take out the old bulb and found it was loose. Surprised, he tightened it and almost fell off the ladder when it suddenly gave out a glaring white light.
"That's more like it," Jonathan said. "Lewis, what's wrong? You're white as a ghost."
I didn't change the bulb," stammered Lewis. "So someone must have loosened it on purpose."
"Unlikely," his uncle said. "It probably just worked its way loose on its own. They sometimes do that, you know. It's caused when turning the light on and off alternately heats and cools the base, causing it to expand and contract."
"Oh, expand and contract yourself, brush mush," said Mrs. Zimmermann tartly. "Cut out the Mr. Wizard stuff. Did you go over to the coal bin?"
"Not that I recall," Jonathan said thoughtfully. "I had just gotten to the bottom of the steps when, bluey, I fell flat on my kisser. Why?"
Mrs. Zimmermann pointed. "Because someone was down here, all right. Someone with big feet."
Lewis looked where she was pointing. The coal bin was empty and disused because Jonathan had changed the furnace over to oil.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.